This is Duke University.
Thank you. Christ is born. Let us adore him. Welcome to worship this morning, this Christmas morning at Duke Chapel. We'd like to also welcome those who are joining us via modern technology, the radio and online. And we're grateful this morning to have Anita Burroughs Price as our harpist. Please rise and let's sing our opening hymn.
Christ, the newborn King, sees into our hearts and souls and loves us despite what he sees there. Let us turn our lives inside out that we may be forgiven and healed by his disarming love. You have given us the peerless gift of grace, but we have left it unwrapped. Lord, have mercy. You have given us abundance, but we are alert only to what is missing. Christ, have mercy. You have given us everything we need, but still we envy what you give to others. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The angels spoke of glory to God in the highest and peace to people on earth. Let's share God's peace and so give God glory.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. God in Trinity, eternal unity of perfect love, as we hear your word this morning, gather the nations to be one family and draw us in to your holy life through the birth of Emmanuel, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah, the 9th chapter. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us, authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace. For the throne of David and his kingdom, he will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness. For this time onwards and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you. The New Testament lesson is from Titus, the second chapter. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training to us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age, to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is it who gave himself to us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. Declare these things, exhort and reprove with all authority. Let no one look down on you. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Luke, the second chapter. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Have you ever been so close to someone that you knew exactly what she would say before she ever said it? My good friend knows her husband just in this way. And a prime example of this happened a few years ago at her family's Christmas celebration. As a joke, several of her family members decided that they would buy a horrendous-looking sweater to give to their brother-in-law. When my friend heard about this gift, she said, "I know exactly how my husband's going to respond. This is what he'll do. He'll look at the gift, and with a cheerfulness in his voice, and maybe even a feigned sense of candor, he'll say, 'I love it.'" So the time came for people to open their gifts, and with breathless anticipation, everyone was watching to see how the husband would respond. Now there was a glint of horror in her husband's eye when he first opened the box. But this was quickly masked by what can only be described as a valiant effort to show excitement and surprise. And then, as if on cue, he said, "I love it." We've all experienced something like this story. We've known the tension of wanting to be thankful for a gift that someone gives, while trying to maintain a sense of personal integrity about our likes and our dislikes. Deep down, we know that both gratitude and transparency are virtues worth embracing. And in our responses to unwanted gifts, some of us lean more toward thankfulness, and some of us lean a little more toward personal integrity. In short, some gifts we don't, and some gifts we want, and some gifts we don't, but we want to be thankful. A significant assumption that we make in our giving and receiving of gifts is that the very best gifts are the ones that someone really wants. It's like getting a pair of skates for Johnny, or a sled for Susie, or a Red Ryder BB gun for that little boy in the Toy Story movie the Christmas Story movie they always show at Christmas time. We're often obsessed with making sure that we get the exact perfect gift for all the special people on our list. We all know folks who spend the extended Christmas season, you know, that goes from about the middle of July until Christmas Eve, trying to find the very perfect gift for all the people on their list. It's no wonder that gift cards are so popular. We reason to ourselves, if she buys it for herself, she'll get exactly what she wants, and therefore we're going to be giving the best gift. It just makes sense. If the best gift is the gift that people want the most, I wonder if God is a very good gift giver. I wonder if the story of Christmas is really about God giving the very best gift. Let's consider a few of the characters from the Christmas story and imagine what they might have wanted for Christmas. First, let's imagine the Emperor Augustus. The emperor had an empire to run. He had to perpetuate the Pax Romana and to ensure the compliance of a diverse population. The emperor had international politics to consider. At the beginning of Luke's story, we hear that the emperor has called for a census. This was a sure measure of his power and his kingdom's wealth. The emperor didn't want any gifts. He wanted to take people's money through tax. The emperor was like the person who has every single thing that he could already want or need, and so there's really no reason to buy him a gift at all. Emperor Augustus didn't need anything. He could take whatever he wanted. The emperor was in control. The very best gift that God could give him would be to refrain from meddling in the emperor's world of power and politics. But God gave a different gift than what the emperor wanted. Let's think about the innkeeper. Business was booming because of the decree of the governing authorities. The first century holiday season in Bethlehem must have been somewhat like the craze on the Friday after Thanksgiving in Walmart. The census surely was a time for businesses to move into the black. Yet the innkeeper knew about the struggle of being overwhelmed by his work. The innkeeper knew the stress of handling capacity crowds and of being over his head with demands that just wouldn't stop piling up. But like other busy business owners, the innkeeper didn't necessarily want less work or fewer occupants. What he wanted was more time, better efficiency, more space, and greater productivity. I wonder if there's an iPad application for that. But God gave a different gift than what the innkeeper wanted. Another character in the story is Joseph. Joseph represents the people of Israel. Luke tells us that Joseph was of the house and lineage of the great king of God's chosen people. Joseph harbored the deep religious and political expectations of the people of God. Like his relatives from Bethlehem, he recalled stories of a bygone era when all of Israel faithfully followed God as they lived in the promised land and worshiped in the temple. As a Jew, Joseph longed for the redemption of Israel. But there's more to Joseph. Betrayal and deep hurt overshadowed Joseph's personal circumstances. The fact that his fiancée's baby was not his complicated the joy of the imminent birth. Imagine the betrayal and jealousy that Joseph must have experienced. Imagine Joseph's awkward and embarrassing conversations with his relatives over Christmas dinner. Congratulations on your marriage. When was the big day? Do you think your baby will look like you? What Joseph wanted was surely a mixture of fulfilling both personal and corporate desires. He longed for the restoration of Israel and something like the return of the days of King David, when Israel occupied the promised land freely. He also desired for something to heal the betrayal he had experienced. He wanted a way to avoid the embarrassment of the baby's questionable paternity. Maybe Joseph's Christmas list included both something like a Back to the Future type time machine to address his personal situation, and a political leader with just the right balance of political savvy and religious integrity to return to his people their days of glory. But God gave Joseph a different gift than he wanted. Mary's the last character for us to consider. Mary knew the realities of being on the underside of society. She was a young, unwed mother-to-be. If rumors of infidelity spread, Mary faced endless possibilities of social and physical death. Beyond that, the absolutely ordinary, yet terribly precarious event of childbirth loomed as she traveled with Joseph on the 6-day journey to Bethlehem. But for all the physical discomfort of the trip, and for the fears associated with childbirth, Mary may have carried another burden leading up to Christmas. Imagine traveling many miles to visit your new family in your spouse's hometown. Anyone who's had a bit of anxiety about spending the holidays with your in-laws probably can imagine some of what Mary felt. I'm speculating a bit here, but if Joseph's extended family was from Bethlehem, why didn't Mary and Joseph stay with them? I wonder if Mary felt unwanted when her new family left her out of the house when she was expecting so soon. Mary surely knew about being on the outside of family, about being left in the night by strangers and kin alike, about being treated like an animal. What Mary wanted for Christmas seems pretty simple: a room, a bed, and a place of welcome in Joseph's household. But God gave a different gift than Mary wanted. In God's gift for Christmas, God did not abide by our best gift standards. Instead, to the politically powerful person who revels in being in control, God gave a vulnerable, dependent, naked baby king. To the overscheduled, overburdened, yet tireless worker who relies on the busyness of the holiday season, God gave a vulnerable, dependent, naked baby Lord. To the one hoping for a new religious and political era, much like the good old days where the right people led the right way, serving the right God, God gave a vulnerable, dependent, naked baby Savior. To the betrayed and embarrassed one who fears public ridicule, and to the one with broken family relationships, God gave the vulnerable, dependent, naked baby Emmanuel. So I wonder, what do you want for Christmas? Maybe what you want is similar to Mary, or Joseph, or the innkeeper, or the emperor. Maybe your wants are material in nature. You long for all that comes with a beautiful house, or a nice car, or the perfect coat. Maybe your wants are deeply personal. You know your job is shaky, or your marriage is on its last leg, or your loved one's health is declining. And all you want is to have a sense of stability and control in your life again. Maybe your wants are more communally oriented. You long for the power to make sure an election turns out right, or to stop climate change, or to resolve a world health crisis. But for Christmas, rather than obliging our material or personal or communal wants, God gives us a vulnerable, dependent, naked baby Jesus. Let's face it, Jesus isn't all we want for Christmas. God didn't give the characters in Luke's story all they wanted for Christmas, and God doesn't give us all we want for Christmas either. God gives the infant Jesus for Christmas. But the Gospels tell a story of how Jesus encountered those who desired different gifts and gave them a chance to see God's gift with new eyes. The Gospels tell how Jesus offered them another chance to receive him. The stories of the Gospels reveal how Jesus overcame their objections and transformed their desires so that they might find joy and life in God's gift. Think again about someone like Mary, someone with unlimited family drama. Later in the gospel story, Jesus encounters his mother again. One time while Jesus was traveling and teaching about the kingdom of God, someone spoke up and let him know that his mother and brothers were there to see him. Maybe you'll remember Jesus' response. He said, "My mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it." Imagine Mary hearing the words of Jesus. Was this Jesus just adding yet another rejection of Mary to her ongoing list of rejections? No, what Jesus offered was a grander vision of family. Imagine knowing that your circle of welcome has expanded infinitely. Imagine the comfort of a new family opened to you through Jesus. What a gift. Think again about someone like Joseph, someone hoping for the right person to be in political power so that God and God's people might again be glorified. Later in the gospel story, Jesus meets someone like this again. Do you remember James and John? They looked for the restoration and redemption of Israel as well. They wanted good people, people a lot like themselves, to be in the positions of authority and power in that kingdom. But Jesus offered something else. Again, Jesus said, "In my kingdom, those who wish to be great among you must be your servant." Imagine how strange Jesus' response must have sounded to James and John. But imagine the freedom of letting go of all your yearnings and strivings for a long-lost past when people just like you are on top. Imagine the awe of knowing that Jesus' kingdom comes when you find yourself at the bottom. What a gift. Think again about someone like the innkeeper, someone whose work is overwhelming and all-consuming. Later in the gospel story, Jesus meets this person in Martha. Jesus was Martha's special guest, and Martha worked without ceasing. Much like my mother during the holidays, she was nonstop to get everything ready. Unlike Martha, her sister Mary sat at Jesus' feet listening to him. In her exasperation, Martha exclaimed to Jesus, "Don't you care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help." Instead of assistance, Jesus offered something else. "Martha, you're worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part." We don't know Martha's response, but can't you imagine the freedom that Martha was given? All her worries about endless to-do lists brought to new light, transformed because the most important thing was that Jesus was with her. What a gift. Think again about someone like the emperor, someone fixed on being in control who depends on maintaining at least a facade of strength. Later in the gospel story, Jesus stands before Pilate. Pilate was the Roman provincial ruler of Judea, known for his inflexibility, self-will, and relentlessness. You remember Pilate's meeting with Jesus. Jesus was accused of leading a revolt and of being a new king. So Pilate asked, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus responded, "You say so." Imagine Pilate's reaction to a king who didn't speak up for himself, who didn't fight to the end, who even embraced his coming death. And imagine Pilate's response when he heard that the crucified Jesus was no longer in the tomb. Could new life really be found in vulnerability? Imagine the freedom of not needing to be in control, of not having to keep up appearances, of not needing to ensure that everything turns out right. What a gift. So I wonder how the gospel story continues for you. Where has Jesus encountered you to transform your wants in the light of the gift that he is? Maybe this Christmas, God is giving you a chance to receive God's gift anew. And isn't that what Christmas is about? Isn't Christmas about God giving people like us another chance for our objections to be overcome by God's transforming gift? Isn't Christmas about God reorienting our wants and desires, our longings and ambitions, our fears and our pains, our brokenness and vulnerabilities in the light of this baby, in the light of God with us? On Christmas, God gave us a naked, vulnerable, dependent baby Jesus. And this is the good news of God's Christmas gift. Because of Jesus, we no longer have to avoid or fear or run from nakedness or dependence or vulnerability. Because in them, we meet God, the God who is with us. When you open God's gift this Christmas day, maybe on second look, you'll say, "I love it," and mean it.
We proclaim with joy our Christmas faith. Please stand to say the creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord God, you give us the gift of yourself for Christmas, forever. We reflect before you what we want for Christmas. What we say we want for Christmas. What we truly, truly, truly want for Christmas. Expand our hearts, dear Lord. Expand our imaginations. Grow our souls, that we may learn to desire what you give us in abundance. That our desires may be shaped by your simplicity, your nakedness, and your vulnerability. transform those of our desires that lead elsewhere. Give us courage to articulate what we truly want until the day comes that what we truly want is you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, this is the season of joy. We bring before you those relationships in our lives that have lost the joy. We pray for all who find no joy in their close relationships, who find no joy in their work or schooling, who find no joy in life. We pray in particular for those for whom our effort to give gifts comes from duty rather than from joy. Help us to find joy in our duties, in our small gestures as well as our grand ones. Help us to find joy in walking every day with you and in those people you have given us to love and to walk with. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, this is the season of glory. Direct our eyes to where your glory is made known. Make us stars that hover above the place where your baby lies. Open our eyes to where that place is. In this city, in this nation, in your world. Be today with those who are born in stables, with those who have no place to lay their head, with those who are treated like animals, rejected by their family or extended family, forced to become refugees. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, this is the season of peace. Show us how to be reconciled with those from whom we are estranged. Walk with the people of Syria and Nigeria and the Congo and those who know no peace today. Be with the United States Congress and all who seek peace in our political system. Be in the hearts of those who seek high office and all who support them. Bring peace to this city of Durham, especially to households who have lost loved ones in violent attacks. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, this is the season of grace and truth. Enlarge our hearts that we may celebrate your grace in all the good gifts you give us that we don't pay for. Enlarge our minds to rejoice in your truth, even when it comes from unexpected places, even when it makes us change our heart and mind, even when it is hard to swallow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father of mercy, in Jesus you made the Word flesh and dwelt among us. Make your words flesh today through the power of your Spirit, and dwell with us now and always. Amen. Our offering goes to the work of Family Health Ministries in Haiti. Let us join the shepherds and the magi in bringing our gifts to the manger. Thank you.
Gracious and giving God, in the birth of a vulnerable, dependent, naked baby Jesus, you gave us the greatest gift imaginable. Thank you for the precious gift of your Son and the extraordinary gift of your dwelling among us. Take these gifts offered here today and use them to protect the vulnerable, empower the dependent, and clothe the naked. In gratitude, we lift up Family Health Ministries in Haiti, and we celebrate the health care, sanitation, potable water, nutrition, family planning, and immunizations that the Blanchard Clinic there provides. In this holy season, we rejoice in the light of Christ's presence, and we trust that in the last day we will awaken to the brightness of his glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. May the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the wise men, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us now and always. Amen.